is it really? It's a nice concept. But even IBM doesn't like it anymore. They wanted to change it, but then they had already branded it, yeah. You know, so they couldn't say we were wrong. So they, instead of saying, at some point we were operating with this concept, cognitive cities, mm-hmm. You know, we said, because cities are also about learning, they're not just smart. And then the guys from IBM said, oh yes, that's exactly what we mean. And then we said, but why aren't you using that word? Oh, we can't, because we already branded everything smart city. So now we call it smarter cities. So it's a little bit, it shows that we are not there anymore, but you know, so it's a lot is driven by vendors and companies and everybody wants to sell something, but nobody has really thought the concept of smart. And that's what we're trying to do. What is it really? There is something behind it. And I think what is behind it is this whole thing of digitalization. So we have to understand digitalization if we want to understand smart cities or how digitalization can be used for the cities. Okay. So that's the that's the idea. So it's really about digitalization. So, and what time is it? I mean, we don't need to...
10 to 12.
We can talk, we don't need to go through all the slides. I think what is really important is, I mean, it's the sequence. It's the, even if we don't get to the end, it's really the way, what we want to share with you is the way we think about things. So each time you disagree on the step, you stop, okay? So, I mean, the traditional way, and the previous MOOC and everything, and the previous MOOC, basically, the previous MOOC we did on managing urban infrastructure systems, I must say, is, you know, is not very original. Basically, this is my field, my area of expertise. I have been teaching this forever, and it was a quite easy MOOC to do. Actually, we didn't put much effort in it. I just took my notes from my classes and created a MOOC with all I had, okay? This was much more difficult because there was nothing that existed. Smart city, there was nothing that existed. We really spent a lot of time and changed and, you know, and said we have to record, but we're not ready to record because we haven't really thought it through and, you know, things like that. But from the traditional urban or the traditional infrastructure thing, it's quite clear. You have an infrastructure layer, a track, a road, an electricity grid, something, and then you have services that are provided on the basis of these infrastructures, okay? The infrastructure, the road is not the service. The bus that drives on the road provides a service. The train track, the station is not the service, maybe a shopping mall, but no. But it's the train that offers the service. So you have the infrastructure, it's not the electricity grid, it's the electricity you consume. Okay, that's the traditional kind of thing. So the customer or the citizen or whatever is linked to the service, but the service is only possible because you have an infrastructure layer. Without street, and I mean that's what I have these problems with my economists, you know. Air transport liberalization, fantastic airplanes, and I tell them, but without airport, no airplanes, okay? You can liberalize whatever you, without air traffic control, no air, you know, it's sort of, there's an infrastructure there that makes the services possible. That's the traditional view. And I think what changes is this digital data layer that comes in between. This is the real novelty. So I'm not saying smart city is hype, you know. But I'm trying to understand what is really the novelty. Okay. And the novelty, I think, is that data layer, digital layer, however you want to call it, even that is not exactly clear what that is. But there is something in between infrastructures and services. Okay. And this novelty, this data layer changes everything. The infrastructure is still there. The road is still there. The bus is still there, but now the customer buys, I don't know, mobility as a service as part of a package of because of the digitalization. Okay? So the other things are still there, but there is some new layer. Then there is also a question, where is this digital layer? Is it above the services, or is it between the services and the infrastructures? And what is the best way to conceptualize? But there is a data layer. Okay? And so we will take, I mean, in the MOOC, we take two examples. We take transport, and we take energy as an example. Okay? But you have your consumption data, all kind of things. You can sell and things like that. You have on your app, you know exactly how my, I can know how much my fridge consumes at home. You know, and turn it off, so because the electricity is more expensive and all that, and that's, there's still a fridge, there's still electricity consumption, but the interface to the customer is now somehow with is now somehow digital, and I think that's that, and that has nothing to do with cities. It's a general phenomenon of everything. Okay, I'll get back to that. So. So what I have 4 points, but maybe, so the first one is just, I think we have to better understand what digital, nothing with cities, what digitalization really is, technically. And then we have to understand what digitalization does, not just to cities, to everything. I mean, the food is digital, the education is MOOC, is digital, okay, and then we can look what does that mean for cities. That's the construction, okay? And then we can have different views of cities, okay? So what is digitalization? I mean, we say it's sort of four things. That can be separated, but ultimately it's the three things together that make up for the digitalization, okay? And this is very much technology. So, and this may be because I would never, I mean, I'm a political scientist originally. If I hadn't ended up in an engineering university, I probably would not be capable to talk about that. I would have a totally different view on these things. But now I live with these engineers. Okay? And they shape things. I mean, so we have, I think data generation is one. We generate more and more data from absolutely everything. Okay, soon this water bottle will have some chip which says whether it'll be full or empty, or you know whether it should be being recycled, or you know, I mean that you have data from everything, including smart self-generated data. It's more cheaper and cheaper to generate these data. The devices become smaller and smaller, and of course you can store these even more and more and more. The data can be packed at ever cheaper cost somewhere. Okay, I'm not saying it's free. I mean that I'm not. This is not techno-optimism. I'm not saying this is a fantastic development that will save humanity. Okay, I'm just trying to describe what is going on. Okay. So there is some optimistic tone in smart cities, you know, it will be fantastic for cities, but I'm not even judging whether that will be good or bad. I'm just trying to describe what happens, okay? So here we have unprecedented amounts of data about everything in real time, okay? That's one thing. Then we have networks. That's another technological development. So traditionally we have a telecom, this we have since quite a while, a telecom infrastructure. Originally it's a cable. Then it became wireless, but it's still a physical infrastructure. You need towers that communicate to each other, and actually you don't know, but the tower, many of these towers are linked to each other via fiber. You know? So it's not the towers that communicate to each other. The towers are linked to fiber where the data go and things like that. But that's a physical telecom infrastructure which is being rolled out absolutely everywhere, okay? At cheaper and cheaper costs. Okay? I once saw a very nice animation of fiber cables laid in the oceans, just over a time period, 15 years. I mean, the ocean is full of these cables. And half of them don't work anymore, but you just put a new one. Okay? Okay, so you have that. Then you have, on top of that, you have a network that basically links, and that's the internet, that links the devices to each other. So you have a computer or that through the telecommunication infrastructure, they can be linked. Okay? What is in here and what is in there can be linked. Okay? So I have data in here, you have data in there, or any place else in the world. Okay? And they can now be linked to each other. Okay? And that's more like protocols and things like that. And then you have a third layer, and we struggled quite a while, you know, to really identify these three layers. This is still something else. Here you have the, I mean, our two things may be linked, but we cannot exchange the data because you have a different format than I. It's a different structure of the data. It's a different kind of thing. So it's one thing is the physical linking of the things. The other thing is the exchange of the data that I can take this, I can take your data, make something out of it. You can take my data, or my fridge can take the data from my cell phone, things like that. So you really need these three, and this is software. This is hardware and standards and things like that, and this is really hardware physical. Okay? Okay, so so then you can link these things together. So we have the three communications layer plus the data themselves that are somewhere. And you know, you have everything at growing capacity, increasing speed, reduced power needs, lower costs, miniaturization. I mean, you have huge progress in all these purely technological progress. This says nothing about is this data useful, stupid, intelligent, wrong, right, manipulated, nothing. I mean, okay.
Alternative.
Yeah. Okay, but you know, this, I think this is the concept of Internet of Things. Everything is linked to each other. So it's no longer just the people, it's the fridge, it's the computer, it's the train, it's the everything connected to each other. Okay? I think that's the next step. So exponentially connected devices, exponentially generated and transmitted, increasing real-time exchange of data. Okay? As I said, I can monitor the consumption of my fridge in France here, right now. Okay? I don't know what use it is for, but it can be done. Okay? Technically, it's possible. Okay? And it's not very expensive. Okay. So this brings it together, and then comes the last thing, I think the third big element between data and then the exchange, the networks, and the analytics. Because what really makes sense out of this is the analytics. I mean, otherwise it's just a cemetery of stupid data, okay? But here also you have really, and I think that's what big data is. I mean, that's what people call big data. I think it's two things. One is the ability to analyze these data, to find some sort, and there we have interesting discussions with our engineers, because our engineers, they think you have data, you run a software program, and then something will emerge from the data. Maybe I'm too much of a social scientist, but you always need to know what you are looking for. In itself, the data don't make any sense. You have to look for something in particular. So it's analyzing, but it's also visualizing. I think that's the second big element. So here you really have huge progress in artificial intelligence, algorithms, all these kind of things. Okay. And all that, I think, together is digitalization. And maybe we're wrong. Maybe in 10 years, we look at these slides in 10 years and we say, oh, how ridiculous we were. We didn't really understand, you know, what was going on or whatever. But currently, I don't know. I think that's sort of the state of the art, how we can look at digitalization. At least I have not seen anything that, but maybe in a few years, you know, we're outdated. There's something different. So, and all this is technical. I mean, this is data storage. I mean, all our engineers, they work on all these things, okay? But they don't really ask what this is good for. I mean, they desperately try to create startups where they can sell something to, you know, a nice visualization tool or a nice analytical tool or something like this, and then they call that smart city. Because, were you there when Fountings was there?
Is this over open data and they call it smart city?
Yeah, whatever. I mean, but no, but I mean, interesting thing. I'm not ridiculing things, you know. So he has this, I'm one of a good colleague professor, you know. He found a Chinese company that has sensors, pollution sensors, you know, and then he puts them on a bus in the city and they drive around, they generate tons of data, and then he can give you a nice map on your cell phone, and when you go jogging, you know you shouldn't run in this street because it's more polluted than this street, and you know, and he hopes he can create a startup, somebody will buy it, and things like that. So that's the kind, I mean, that's the kind of things that comes out of it, and that's smart city, okay? It's one portion of smart city. Okay, fine, but and I'm not against it. I'm not ridiculing it. But so that's what you get. Okay, so there were a lot of.
I just wanted to say, just to put it as a question. I mean, everybody is talking about data and how important it is to supposedly take better decisions. And there was this guy yesterday who was telling a lot about how important it is data to take better decisions, but I'm not sure even if it is this way, you know. I'm just setting it as a question, like, I'm not sure if better data will make us take better decisions about our cities. When, you know, we have seen that cities that had long history of development and growth, like in the older centuries that didn't have any data, they were growing much better than cities that, you know, were growing, you know, supposedly in the recent ages. And I don't think it's a lack of data that, you know, took a lot of wrong decisions. I think it's
okay, just before, if I may.
Yeah.
I don't want an answer to that. I'm just saying.
No, it's not an answer, it's just a thought. I mean, I think what I describe here is a fact. It's a reality. You have this thing. Now, the question is, who? Because at the very end I come to, I mean, for whom? So as an individual, maybe it's useful to have an app,
yeah,
and you're even prepared to pay for your app so you don't jog in the polluted streets, okay? Maybe, okay? So that's the individual perspective. Then there is the vendor perspective, and you know, the vendors want to sell the storage devices, they want to sell the artificial intelligence tools, they want to sell the apps, they want to sell the telecom. And each of these companies we saw, you know, they say we are now a smart city company because they have a little piece in this whole thing. Okay, fine. That's also an interest. I'm not judging whether, you know. And then there is a collective interest, the city. Okay, but that's another interest. That's not your individual interest. That's not the vendor's interest. And you have to define a perspective to analyze the data. And that's maybe what is lacking, or
yeah.
at least that's what, you know, we really work on this socio-technical. So there's technology, but there's something else. There's not just technology. So go ahead.
Sorry, I just have to respond as an economist, which is, yes, like data does help decision-making. At least I think it does. And I know that like there are different perspectives, but you know, I think urbanization as it happened previously, like maybe in Europe and in the US, happened over like a prolonged period of time in a way that was coupled with industrialization production that has led to like functioning cities. I think the way urbanization is happening now is, again, I can only speak from one context because it really I'm only very familiar with the Eastern African context. It's happening so quickly, so unplanned, and we don't understand it. We have no idea what's going on, right? And we don't have data. To better understand what's going on and how we can do it.
You have more data than you had 20 years ago.
No, we do. Well, we're only, so that last blue box, right, is the really important one.
Yeah.
Because we have more data, but you know how much data is sitting around and no one analyzes it, no one uses it, right? And I think the flip side, and again, maybe this is just speaking from the economist perspective, we have limited resources, like very limited resources. So I think in that context, the data is what helps you take a decision to the best of your knowledge based on limited resources. But I would agree that we have more data than ever, and I would say that that blue box of the analysis is just very much lacking of that data. We're only realizing now how much we have and how much we can use, right?
Yeah, but each actor, can analyze, potentially each actor can analyze these data, but it takes resources, money, time, investment, things like that. And some can analyze these data better than others. Some have more resources, some are faster, some have access to the data, some have not access to the data. You know, it's not, this is a little bit also the other, this is around, but it's not around for everybody.
No,
So, my personal reflection is that I cannot imagine you make a decision without any information or data. Right? So you always, but I don't disagree with you, but I just want to elaborate a little bit. So you always use data. What I understand from your point is that people are now putting too much emphasis on the importance of data, and then that sometimes leads to ignoring quite a lot of other preconditions to make good decisions or a functioning city. And that I agree totally, but the fact that we have more data potentially can help make better decisions. Because we always rely on data to do some kind of analysis. There is a drawback on that, and then this is Faltin's, claim in the MOOC, which you will listen to in a month or so, that a very big problem with big data is that it's always biased. So data is about what happened past. And then if you rely too much on that, one of the consequences is that you always backcast and make decisions which are correct for past. But when you're in a complex system, the problem is that the state of the system is totally different from what it was even a week ago. Now you go and dig out data for the previous 12 months, and then you make a decision which is not necessarily correct.
But Mohammed, you're talking about that versus using data from a 2002 census. I'm happy to be a week off, right? Rather than more than a decade off, right? I think there is a trade-off, when you're talking about data, very data-scarce environments, right? Uganda, we actually have more data than a lot of other, Kampala has more data than a lot of other cities. But again, a 2002 census, that said we had
probably double the population.
More than. We have a growth rate that's more than doubling, right? We can't base our decisions on that,
but
right?
That's a relevant and correct point. My point is that you have the data, it's important, it shouldn't ignore the other dimensions, and I totally agree with Yanis on that. So the data should not become the god of the whole thing. Then everyone just refers to the data. There is quite a lot of dimensions. And then there's a drawback. Even if you rely too much on data and you are not aware of all the weaknesses that it has, you would make crappy decisions.
And
then you would be so much happy that it's relied on data that you even ignore, the consequences. So it's just a warning. It doesn't mean that you shouldn't use the data, but it needs to have a balanced perspective. That's the only thing.
I want to say that, seeing the problems that, Mexico City, for example, has, even if they had all the data and all the analysis, 30, 20 years ago, I'm not sure the city would have grown and would have evolved in a much different, fashion than that. I don't think it was a lack of data. That's what I'm saying. It's other issues that have to be tackled, and these don't have to do with data.
Okay, good. I think it's a good point. I wanted to add even another point. We have the Trump effect. People who just ignore data. It's becoming so over, there is so much data and everything that people say, okay, to hell with data.
Alternative data. It's not analyzed, it's not completely...
Yeah. Or just pick the data that tell me, I like these data, I don't like that data.
But definitely I think that the challenge is the big data analysis. For instance, in Kampala, there is not a challenge because there's not a lot of data.
So we're like I'm trying to use mobile phone data.
I'm sure they have a whole new skill.
Okay.
I you know I'm an economist. You have a master's degree, but I cannot analyze this data without like a new training and whatnot. And it's like super exciting data, but it's really difficult to manipulate. At least I think so. And I think you're right that it's also a challenge, like how you can use it.
It's more complicated than it is.
Absolutely.
Now they're trying to use radio data, and they're trying to use like machine learning to figure out like what people are talking about on the radio, because it's the primary form of media, and like machine learning to pick up these different things. But you need like, I don't know, a PhD in something or other to be able to even like create those algorithms that can do that, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. Let's come back to these kind of things. So this is, you know, this is just basically that what digital, I mean, I just try to describe what digitalization is, okay? And now I want to look at the effects of this. Okay? So what does that do? And the big buzzword today is disruption. You know, it disrupts whatever. And it does, but I think we have to understand what exactly, how does it exactly work, okay? Including on cities. So you understand what I'm trying to do. I'm just trying to logically sort of get us to smart cities, okay? So what are the implications? And first, I sort of have two steps. First is, and there is now a little literature, not much, but the implications of digitalization, those are mostly economists. The implication of digitalization on industries. Okay. And you know, my area, originally I come from the postal sector. Okay. And I can tell you that digitalization has disrupted postal services. I mean, we have volume losses. You still have a postal operator in Uganda? Still exists?
It's always existed, it's never functioned.
Okay.
Like it's there.
So you have okay, but in many African countries, we don't even have anymore. So we just have DHL, okay? But, you know, it's sort of, I mean, we have in Europe, we have volume declines of 5-7% per year of physical mail, okay? Just substituted by digitalization, okay? So that's disruptive. Okay, so in order to get at that, I want to sort of, you know, in different steps. One is we have a traditional physical value chain. You produce, I don't know, you produce a car, you take you assemble it, and at the end you send it, you sell it to the customer. It's purely physical, okay? It can be anywhere in the planet, doesn't matter, okay? And that's a value chain. That's what I still teach. That's what's in the textbooks, okay? They haven't followed, you know, really. So the customer pays 100 for the car, and then it's distributed among the different steps in the value chain. Each one gets something, and that depends on bargaining power and all these kinds of things. Okay? Now, what does digitalization do? Okay. So the physical value chain is still there. The car is still there. It's still being produced. The food is still being produced. But you, and there I'm using this word, duplication or mirroring. The information for each, the data of each of these steps, how much, I don't know how long it took them to produce and when it was produced and all this, is now put into a digital layer or data layer. This information is somewhere, okay? And the customer is now moving from the physical. The customer buys the car, maybe the car is not a good example, the Dell computer, buys the Dell computer on the internet, you know, and the customer is, or the Amazon book or something, the book is being produced. I mean, somebody writes it, then somebody prints it, somebody puts a cover, somebody, you know, ships it, whatever, but the customer is not, that doesn't go to the bookshop, he or she goes to the Amazon web and buys digitally. And so there is, because there is an electronic duplicated mirrored value chain there. Okay. I think this is just how it functions. Okay. And then on top of that, you can make out of these data you can make new services and businesses on business models because you have all these data. That's what, if I stay with Amazon, they say, oh, you buy this book, and people who bought this book also bought this book, so maybe I'll give you, you know, and today it's still books, but tomorrow they say, okay, and people who bought this book, they also have this aftershave, and you know, they wear these clothes, and you know, you can get into new businesses, maybe new customers, things like you can commercial, you can make something out of these data. So if I come back to my postal operators, they have all the data about all the parcels, about everything, and where people live, and whether they are at home or whether they are not at home, or whether they pick up the mail or whether they don't. You know, they have everything. And what do? And they don't make any money out of that anymore. But they make money by selling this information to other companies who want to know whether you are at home and how often you are at home and things. And they make business out of the data that they have generated. Okay? So I think that's the reality. And here is very much the software. If you have good analytical tools, you can make business models out of these data. Okay. So what happens? I mean, between here and here, I think we see the disruption of traditional physical industries. And that's not from me. This is from this book called Platform Revolution, which I think is the only thing that I have read intelligent in digital business so far. Basically say the industries that are more disrupted are the industries that are information intensive, like banking or something like this, or insurances or things like that. The industries that are not really scalable, that's typically the taxi industry, you know? I mean, it's always a local taxi, but if you can aggregate on a higher level, you can disrupt. The industries that are very, very fragmented, that is mobility, because it's fragmented between the bikes and the cars and the taxis and the buses and things like that. And the industries where there's a lot of information asymmetry, lawyers and education, those are the ones that will be more faster disrupted than, for example, oil and gas extractive industries, you know, things like that. So not all the industries are equally disrupted, but ultimately everything will be disrupted. So here, I think this is sort of we have typically, you know, logistics and transport, energy, banking, healthcare, information asymmetry, and all that. Doctors, you get your diagnosis on the web, you know, is better than the one you get from the doctor, and then you know, things like that. And government, a lot of government service. I think government is very much in danger of being disrupted. Government services. Okay, so that's one thing. And then from here, you know, we have to see, now I'm getting to infrastructures, okay? So this is typical industries, any industries. Now I'm trying to bring this down to what that means for the infrastructure. So we had this thing before, infrastructure and services, the digital layer in between. And now let's look at this, what happens? And I think it has two effects really. One is, I mean, and that's what we call smart energy or smart transport or smart water or smart, in my view, it's basically about efficiency. It's to manage these infrastructures more efficiently. Thanks to this data layer, you have a better information about more optimally managing the infrastructure. You can do, I mean, if we take the integrated timetable, you people waste less time because you can better plan. We have on energy consumptions, we can do, I do energy regulation, so thanks to the smart meter, we have a better picture about the consumption, we can balance the energy grid better. I don't think it's a lot about the environment. I mean, it's sustainability because simply it's more efficient. Okay. And and I see that very positively. I think, you know, smart infrastructure management, thanks to the digital layer, makes infrastructures more efficient, okay? Meaning maybe you need less investments, you can optimize more. I mean, in Switzerland we're now discussing, I mean, our train system is saturated, okay? Trains are full, people stand, okay? It's just because we have too much population, okay? And then you cannot invest in infrastructure anymore because everything is built, okay? So what can you do thanks to this? We have all kind of apps where we tell people that if you take the train 1 hour later, you know, the train will be less full, that we need to invest less into the infrastructure so we can optimize the use of, you know, things like that. We'll give you a discount. It's still cheaper to subsidize a little bit more than to build. I think you can, and I think that's, I mean, what much of what people call smart city or smart infra, that's about that. It's about efficiency. And it's positive. I mean, but then I think there's something else, and that could be smart new services. Now, this is much less clear, but you could, out of these data, you can offer new services. And mobility, I think you have talked here about mobility as a service and things like that. You know, those are new services offered because you have that data layer, because you can now link, you know, when the bus arrives and then the train parts and things like that. You can offer new services because of the digital infrastructure. We can offer new energy services, for example. Okay, so for example, electricity, you know, now if I can sell my electricity that I generate I can sell it to somebody else who is willing to buy, you know, and of course I cannot do it myself because some intermediary already appeared and said, I make a business out of this, I help you sell your energy, things like that, new service. Okay, so if we apply this to city, I think this is not really, I mean, that's why I called it city 1+0 or 1+1 or something like that. It's still not really disruptive. What is disruptive is this: if we get to new services, that would be city 2.0 or 3.0 or 4.0, something like this. But I think it's important to make that distinction between optimizing the infrastructures and offering some new types of services. Okay, so what does that mean for cities? Okay. Now, this is, when we discussed before, this is our traditional conceptual framework. We basically said, you know, there is a metropolitan area, there are urban infrastructures, and then we have performance. That's why we talk about, you know, efficiency, sustainability, or resilience, okay? And then we have the governance of these infrastructures, governance and management of these infrastructures, which determines how performing they are, okay? This leads to quality of life competitiveness, then the citizens and the businesses, they influence the governance, and then, Mohammed, this is our original conceptualization. And we have, all this is IGLU's concept, we have the challenges, the different challenges, and now digitalization, I think, is everywhere. Okay. It's, and I think that's the pervasive nature of digitalization. The digitalization is even in the governance, in the way you, I mean, what I said before, government services and all that are, you can govern differently thanks to digital, to the information that you have. Okay. So here, those are the different sort of concepts. And I'm not sure this is totally, you know, we would even say that today anymore. But different people call things differently, you know. So people who use the word smart city, I think they very much come from the technological dimension. I mean, what we discussed before. This is technologically possible. We can monitor this. We have data on this. We can analyze this. So I think the concept of smart city is very much linked to that technological dimension. If I look how people use things, but you have other words. We have this all these concepts of the digital economy. They come a little bit from a different angle. I think we have this initiative in Switzerland, big thing called Digital Switzerland. Okay, and if you look, what is it? What do they think? What the people who promote these concepts? What do they think? They think actually not what I have talked about so far. They think about attracting companies that are telecom companies or data analytics companies or smart metering companies or things like that. The digital economy is the economy where the jobs are created in the digital industries. But it's not at all, you know, the digital economy is the one that is, as I said, disruptively changed by digitalization. Okay? I think that's how they would. So at least when I look at all these people who talk about digital economy, is basically looking, it's sort of a continuation of the service economy. Okay, people worked in agriculture, then they worked in industry, then worked in services, and now they work in the digital world, and that's the digital economy. Okay? And we have to help that because that's the future and agriculture is the past. And you know, and sort of we have to create conditions for them so they can create startups and make money on this, and we have to invest into education, so you know, but this is the digital economy, and that has nothing to do, in my view, with smart. It's just an economic look at digitalization as an industry, okay? At least when I mean, I'm very much involved now in Switzerland in all this stuff, you know, and the government is doing tons of things. And when you look, when it comes down to it, it's about how can we attract the Googles of the world? I mean, why should Google be in California and not in Zurich? I mean, that's their basic problem, okay? And how can we create the conditions for these companies to come here? Okay? And then we're a digital economy. Okay. Then we have, I think, these people here, political people, e-governance, e-participation, basically using digitalization for citizen involvement. And as I told you, I had this master before on e-governance. I was very much there. I mean, coming from political science, you know, I said, okay, there is more to digitalization than startups. There's more to digitalization than apps. Digitalization could help democracy, better participation, people getting more actively involved. You know, it's a very optimistic view of I think we would look at these things a little bit more critically today, you know, fake news, all these kind of, you know, people acting on okay. So I think we have these people. And then we have, on the social dimension, we have this kind of, I don't know, online communities, new digital communities instead of physical communities. I mean, those would be more the sociologists who talk about the Castells and these kind of people. You know, we have new identities that are created, they're not bound physically, that, you know, are online and all that. Yeah.